Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Thomas Paine, Enlightenment, Revolution, and the Birth of Modern Nations by Craig Nelson, narrated by Paul Hecht. This recording is copyrighted 2006 by Recorded Books. The author opens with the following three quotes. The first is by Cicero. "Not to have knowledge of what happened before you were born is to be condemned to live forever as a child." The next quote that opens this book is by Plato. "The penalty good men pay for not being interested in politics is to be governed by men worse than themselves." And the final quote included here is by American playwright Arthur Miller. "There have been so many writers who dominated a period and then slipped off. History is like some gigantic beast. It simply wriggles its back and throws off whatever is on it." And now, Thomas Paine.
Chapter 1. The Mission of Atonement. Just before daybreak, on or about September the 25th in the year 1819, a 56-year-old Englishman by the name of William Cobbett found himself 22 miles due north of New York City, stumbling, pink-faced and ardent, through the wild blackness of Westchester, followed by his son, J.P., and a hired hand. The night was dank and blind, and crowded with a raucous blur of a thousand unseen creatures. For though the myriad flocks and herds of the New World would in time be annihilated for their fur, their meat, and the carnal pleasure of taking a life, at that moment the continent was as awash in wildlife as an African dream. Bald eagles nested along the Manhattan riverbanks, and catamounts prowled the outskirts of Greenwich Village. As Cobbett and his men scurried forward into the darkness, they found themselves engulfed by the moans of frogs, the rasps of crickets, the pierce of owls, the bark of foxes, the mourning of wolves. Burdened by a large box and an assortment of picks and shovels, the men made their way across the border of the French Protestant refuge of New Rochelle, hindered by using as few torches as possible in order to travel unnoticed. Even so, at the nearby tavern owned by Charity Badeau, her son Albert heard the men in the dead of night and alerted the authorities. Now Cobbett and his men could hear a group of local magistrates in the distance, approaching. They hurried along as well as could be managed, helped by their leaders, knowing exactly where his quarry lay, having traced the route numerous times before in daylight hours. Finally, he and his men arrived at their destination and hurriedly began to dig. Even taking into account that era's Renaissance style of gentlemanly pursuits, exemplified by printer, natural philosopher, essayist, businessman, inventor, civic servant, and diplomat Benjamin Franklin, William Cobbett had pursued a significant range of trades over the course of one lifetime. Soldier, publisher, Tory, radical, Commons deputy, essayist, and Long Island farmer who loathed the potato but championed the rutabaga, he is primarily known today for Rural Rides, an ode to bucolic Albion. "I knew that my road lay through a hamlet called Chert, where they grow such fine Bennett grass seed. There was a moon, but there was also a hazy rain. I am here got into some of the very best barley land in the kingdom, a fine, buttery, stoneless loam upon a bottom of sand or sandstone. Finer barley and turnip land it is impossible to see." Regardless of such reveries on beloved turnip lands, Cobbett was, in the flesh, a bare-knuckled, go-for-broke political gladiator, perennially struggling to change the mass beliefs of humankind. He was that type of man whose emotions fattened until they became intolerable, and something had to be done, especially when it came to righting social injustice. Cobbett would have his first great political epiphany in 1792, when, as a 29-year-old sergeant major newly retired from the British Army, he followed the House of Commons debate on whether to raise taxes to pay soldiers 3 shillings a week. The men were already supposed to be receiving that sum, but endemic graft meant they got only about half that, and Secretary of War George Young had decided that the answer was to increase revenue instead of trying to stop the service's long-standing corruption. Cobbett, made bitter from his years in the army by his own commander's habitual larceny, challenged this position with The Soldier's Friend, a pamphlet exploring the history of state-sanctioned bunco. His Majesty's government replied by throwing Soldier's publisher James Ridgway into prison for 4 years and forcing the new author to flee the country. Cobbett arrived in the United States to find a nation exactly the contrary of what I expected. The land is bad, rocky, the seasons are detestable, the people are worthy of the country, cheating, sly, roguish. Instead of that perfect freedom and that amiable simplicity of which Paine had given me so flattering a description, I found myself placed under a set of petty, mean despots, ruling by the powers given them by a perversion of the law of England. In Philadelphia, he taught English to Parisians, fleeing the French Revolution. Their horrific accounts, combined with his own infinite disappointment in the ways of American democratic government, threw Cobbett's political beliefs into a full-throttle reverse. He opened a print shop, a business incorporating the entire 18th-century media universe of letters, broadsides, newspapers, pamphlets, magazines, and books, decorated it with portraits of King George III, and, under the byline Peter Porcupine, wrote such rabble-rousing commentary as calling democracy a despotism of the many over the few, and Benjamin Franklin a whoremaster, a hypocrite, and an infidel. His cantankerous and rabidly pro-British, pro-federalist Porcupine's Gazette quickly became North America's most widely read periodical. In 1797, he referred to Philadelphia's scion and American founding father Benjamin Rush as Dr. Sangrado, and denounced his widespread use of bloodletting, a form of medical terror. Rush sued for libel, and, perhaps assisted by the judge's close friendship with Rush's attorney, won an astounding $5,000, around $400,000 today. Forced to shut down Porcupine's Gazette, Cobbett tried to replace it with the American Rush Light, by the help of which wayward and disaffected Britons may see a complete specimen of the baseness, dishonesty, ingratitude, and perfidy of Republicans, and of the profligacy, injustice, and tyranny of Republican government. But this did not satisfy Rush or the court, and he fled jurisdiction once again. Returning to London, Cobbett issued both The Porcupine, Fear God, Honor the King, and Cobbett's Political Register, which went undelivered until he stopped refusing to make kickback payoffs to Britain's post office secretary. When Cobbett then decried the army's use of flogging, he was tried and found guilty of sedition and was sentenced to 2 years' confinement in Europe's most notorious prison, Newgate. By the time of his release, Cobbett had come to believe that he had spent his American years living in a fool's paradise, blind to the debauched march of English history. Now he found that Britain's wealthy had only gotten richer, and its working class had fallen further into poverty. He saw the starving poor riot for food, and the government do nothing except order soldiers to beat the mobs into a cowed retreat. He now viewed Whitehall as a repulsive and degenerate system of graft and patronage, controlled by oligarchs and plutocrats, a system he called the Thing, a thing that was turning Englishmen away from the nation's great traditions of honor and virtue into a wholly self-interested horde of beasts. Cobbett was baffled and aggrieved. How had this happened to his great nation? How could it be remedied? He found an answer in The Decline and Fall of the English System of Finance, an essay linking Britain's never-ending warmongering to her escalating national debt, crushing taxes, and over-reliance on paper money. Decline and Fall's author ominously predicted that the Bank of England would fail, and when the following year the bank indeed suspended cash payments, Cobbett realized that he had found the political and philosophical fount he had been looking for all his life. At his expiring flambeau, he would explain just before he died. I lighted my taper. By this time, Cobbett had grown a torso as burly as in any John Bull legend, topped by bushy, snow-white hair and equally bushy, snow-white eyebrows, along with the burnt skin of a weekend farmer, pink as a Christmas ham. He had become England's most popular journalist, selling 40,000 copies of the Weekly Political Register at a price working men could afford. The government responded to this achievement by passing gagging acts and a suspension of habeas corpus, forcing him once again to leave England for the United States. He returned to what he now believed was an American paradise, mercifully untainted by the English thing. Just a few decades before, there had existed a coterie of men and one woman known variously as progressives, radicals, philosophes, illuministi, and founding fathers who had come to the fantastical notion that civilization could be improved through the application of human reason and science. This group of modern thinkers, united through their constant interactions in the Republic of Letters, believed they had it in their power to begin the world over again, to end relentless poverty and widespread ignorance while destroying the mindless and oppressive power of parasitic monarchs and idle aristocrats. In time, through their efforts, the lives of millions of ordinary people would be dramatically improved, and many of their febrile dreams, once widely ridiculed, would become so commonplace that today it is a struggle to appreciate the dramatic labor of their births. By the early 19th century, however, their era of profound hope was in eclipse, its astounding, brilliant figures either dead, ridiculed, or wholly ignored. The citizens of America had entirely repudiated their own founding fathers, turning away from the Enlightenment's optimistic vision of progress for the future, belief in the infinite powers of natural philosophy, and admiration for ancient Rome's republican heroes in favor of evangelical religion, land speculation, bargain corn whiskey, kaleidoscopes, and a style of clothing and interior decorating that would come to be known by historians as American fancy. The European avant-garde, who had once hoped to drive out corrupt monarchies and establish democratic republics, had in turn been silenced by the reigns of terror, Bonaparte, and England's Pitt the Younger. While a Tory Federalist living in Philadelphia, Cobbett had attacked this group of do-gooders, claiming that their humanity, like that of all the reforming philosophers of the present enlightened day, is of the speculative kind. It never breaks out into action. 2 decades later, he would, in fact, evolve into one of these reforming philosophers himself, carrying on the utopian missions of the previous century in an attempt to destroy the thing and restore England to a golden age of selfless virtue. In returning to his progressive roots, he would have an almost religious conviction that the fount that had awakened him politically and philosophically one full and final time was, in fact, the true father of the United States— not a general, but a writer, for before the sword there is always the word, and not just any writer, but the most famous and popular author of the entire 18th century. During the final years of Thomas Paine's life, William Cobbett had been one of his most public and brutal foes, using Porcupine's Gazette to attack him on issue after issue. How Tom gets a living now, or what brothel he inhabits, I know not, he wrote during Paine's last years in physical and professional decline. Whether his carcass is at last to be suffered to rot on the earth or to be dried in the air is of very little consequence. Whenever and wherever he breathes his last, he will excite neither sorrow nor compassion. No friendly hand will close his eyes, not a groan will be uttered, not a tear will be shed. Like Judas, he will be remembered by posterity. Men will learn to express all that is base, malignant, treacherous, unnatural, and blasphemous by the single monosyllable pain. Having witnessed the turns of history in the years since Paine's death, however, Cobbett had undergone a profound conversion. Any man may fall into error, but a fool or a knave will seldom acknowledge it. I saw Paine first pointing the way, and then leading a nation through perils and difficulties of all sorts to independence and to lasting liberty, prosperity, and greatness. Cobbett had become certain that his erstwhile nemesis had been right about everything all along, and in turn, he was now Thomas Paine's most devoted acolyte. He immediately became a friend to Madame Bonneville, the woman who had inherited Paine's literary estate and worked to ensure that all of the great man's writing would be safeguarded and eventually published. He interviewed as many friends and acquaintances as possible in order to produce a definitive Paine biography, doing penance for having been the American publisher of Francis Aldous's The Life of Thomas Paine, a slanderous attack subsidized by the British government. What Cobbett could not undo, or scarcely bear, was Paine's debased reputation. How could the American people ignore this hero who had convinced their ancestors to renounce the depraved government of their homeland and build a new world, this author who had conceived and written the very principles on which their nation was founded, this theorist whose writings were the very essence of what it meant to be an American? This man who had fought so publicly for decades over the United States' very right to exist as something beyond an abused and belittled colony. At the same time, the citizens of Britain were rejecting this visionary, who had been threatened with execution and who had suffered lifelong exile from his native country solely because he attempted to gain political powers for the common Englishman for the first time in that nation's history. William Cobbett arrived at one conclusion. If no one else would put things right, then he, who had participated so eagerly in everything that was wrong during his early Tory years in America, would have to make amends. He would perform one heroic, glorious act of atonement that would startle the world and reignite humanity's appreciation for the extraordinary ideas and writings of Thomas Paine. The Porcupine had insinuated what he was about to attempt in upstate New York through letters and in the Political Register. Paine lies in a little hole under the grass and weeds of an obscure farm in America. There, however, he shall not lie unnoticed much longer. These bones will affect the reformation of England in church and state. Never will England be what it ought to be until the marble of First Minister William Pitt's monument is converted into a monument to the memory of Paine. He belongs to England. His fame is the property of England, and if no other people will show that they value that fame, the people of England will. Cobbett had decided that he would exhume the decade-old corpse of Thomas Paine from his long-forgotten grave on deserted New Rochelle farmland. He would then sail with it to London and there construct the grand mausoleum that he fervently believed the greatest hero of the century truly deserved. The digging, even with the coming of first light, was difficult. Finally, the deteriorating cadaver was fully unearthed and transferred to a box less unwieldy than its mahogany casket. Cobbett decided that he could not live without the headstone and took that as well. As the local sheriffs drew closer, the three men ran, fumbling with their cargo, barely outracing the deputies to New Rochelle's Hudson River docks. Cobbett and J.P. then returned to Hyde Park, their family farm on Long Island, to make final preparations, as the house had burned down the year before they had to sleep in a tent, and the following week they sailed on the Hercules with the corpse to England. During a customs inspection at Liverpool on November the 21st, 1819, Cobbett opened his various bits of luggage and, revealing the body, announced, "There, gentlemen, are the mortal remains of the immortal Thomas Paine." Apparently he had decided not to continue on to London with the stone, as James Dow revealed in a letter to a progressive New York periodical, The Truth Seeker, on August the 8th, 1909. "Since October 1819, the gravestone has been in the quiet and continuous custody of the Rushton family in this city. It has never been publicly exhibited and is regarded as an heirloom. The gravestone was presented by William Cobbett to Edward Rushton between the 31st of October 1819 and the 28th of November. The widow of Edward Rushton's son possesses the stone and is indisposed to restore it to the public. As Cobbett and his luggage pass through Bolton, the town crier announced the arrival of Mr. Thomas Paine and was consequently jailed for 9 weeks. When Cobbett arrived in London and explained to the world his grand vision, the reaction was not at all what he hoped. The English government refused permission for his plans for a colossal statue in bronze of Paine. When his working men, readers, then failed to rally to the cause to force Whitehall to reconsider, Cobbett decided to exhibit the bones for an entry fee of 1 tuppence to raise money for his fund for reform and to fashion Paine's hair around metal rings to wear in his honor. Nothing came of these schemes, however. The incident instead turned into a national joke, with the English Tory press taunting Cobbett as a resurrection man, referring to those who made a living by supplying medical schools with cadavers of dubious origins. And Lord Byron himself quatrained, "In digging up your bones, Tom Paine, Will Cobbett has done well. You visit him on earth again, he'll visit you in hell." The scandal would become so well known in its day that it generated an endless series of political cartoons ridiculing Cobbett, as well as a popular nursery rhyme. "Poor Tom Paine, there he lies, nobody laughs and nobody cries. Where he has gone or how he fares, nobody knows and nobody cares." Such attitudes would foreshadow the next 2 centuries of public thinking about the man who was once considered the most important political writer of his century. Though poor Tom was a founder of both the United States and the French Republic, the creator of the phrase United States of America, and the author of the 3 biggest bestsellers of the 18th century, he is known today by the educated public primarily through biographies for children. At the same time, since he wholeheartedly followed a motto that life should be a daring adventure or nothing, his personal drama and historic achievements have inspired a never-ending chain of advocates, apostles, and cultists. For centuries after his death, Paine would be remembered as a filthy, poverty-stricken, drunken wastrel and an unoriginal thinker, an image engineered by his great foes, the American Federalist Party of John Adams and the British government of King George III. In fact, in his lifetime, he was considered on intellectual par with the giants of his century, and far from being impoverished, he left an estate worth nearly $1 million in today's money. He clearly had a charm, style, and intelligence that others found overpoweringly attractive, since he rose from the lowest ranks of working-class England to the highest levels of the era's global intellectual society, becoming a friend or ally to the century's greatest luminaries, Benjamin Franklin, George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Rush, James Monroe, Jean-Jacques Danton, Jacques-Pierre Brissot, Antoine-Nicolas de Condorcet, William Blake, Joseph Priestley, Richard Price, William Godwin, and Mary Wollstonecraft. Indeed, though from the last years of his life to the present day, Paine has been considered one of the most controversial figures in American history, nearly all of his writings reflect the consensus opinion of his Enlightenment peers. He's been quoted in admiration by figures as diverse as Ronald Reagan, Walt Whitman, Richard Pearl, the intellectual father of the American war in Iraq, Andrew Jackson, and Abraham Lincoln. And all of them are right to claim him. Thomas Edison thought Paine the equal of Washington in making American liberty possible. Where Washington performed, Paine devised and wrote. Among his detractors was Teddy Roosevelt, who pronounced him nothing but a dirty little atheist. John Adams at first told Thomas Jefferson that history is to ascribe the American Revolution to Thomas Paine, but later would dismiss him as a disastrous meteor. In fact, when his momentous era began to be known by the title of Paine's last great work, Adams would protest with his signature melodramatic flair, a key talent for an 18th-century trial lawyer. "I am willing you should call this the age of frivolity as you do, and would not object if you had named it the age of folly, vice, frenzy, brutality, demons, Bonaparte, Tom Paine, or the age of the burning brand from the bottomless pit, or anything but the age of reason. I know not whether any man in the world has had more influence on its inhabitants or affairs for the last 30 years than Tom Paine. There can be no severer satyr on the age. For such a mongrel, between pig and puppy, begotten by a wild boar on a bitch-wolf, never before in any age of the world was suffered by the poltroonery of mankind to run through such a career of mischief. Call it, then, the age of Paine. Adam's screed came at the end of decades of philosophical conflict between the two men. Both he and Paine loved out-and-out warfare, but the significance he ascribes to his opponent was patently true. Paine's writings were a fundamental source for European and American ideas of society and government. Almost everything about America and Americans that is globally admired today is found in his work. Almost every issue he raised is still at issue in our own times. Almost every argument in which he engaged, most obviously his verbal duel with Edmund Burke over whether ordinary human beings are civilized enough to govern themselves, is still being argued more than 200 years later. And if the journalistic credos of speaking truth to power, comforting the afflicted and afflicting the comfortable have a godhead, that would have to be Thomas Paine, whose writing was so provocative and so uncompromising that he faced the gibbet and the blade everywhere he was published, in England and in France and in the United Colonies. Practically every human detail about the 17th century's lodestone figure Isaac Newton is now lost to us, even the specifics of his physical appearance. The same is almost true of Paine, the vast majority of whose documents were either deliberately or accidentally destroyed, and who shared with Newton the status of having created such fundamental theory that today it is nearly impossible to understand his ideas as the revolution in thinking they once were. History rises from primary documents, but in Paine's case these have been decimated, while the key secondary sources include a propagandist hired by the British government, a one-time Paine ally writing for vengeance, and a besotted acolyte overwhelmed by love for his subject. During the last years of Paine's life, he would have an all-too-common writer's dispute with New York newspaper editor James Cheatham, a dispute that became so heated he would use his celebrity to uncommonly and somewhat deservedly attack his editor's professionalism. Cheatham would wait until the week of the official announcement of Paine's death and then take his vengeance with a biography of vicious slurs. Under the guise of a fair and balanced journalist, he sent a query letter to a near-lifelong Paine friend. Joel Barlow replied with a description of the difficulties Cheatham would face in composing his life. If this piece of biography should analyze his literary labors and rank him as he ought to be ranked among the brightest and most undeviating luminaries of the age in which he has lived, yet with a mind assailable by flattery and receiving through that weak side a tincture of vanity which he was too proud to conceal, with a mind, though strong enough to bear him up, and to rise elastic under the heaviest load of oppression, yet unable to endure the contempt of his former friends and fellow laborers, the rulers of the country that had received his first and great services. If you are disposed and prepared to write his life, thus entire, to fill up the picture to which these hasty strokes of outline give but a rude sketch with great vacuities, your book may be a useful one. It is said he was always a peevish intimate, but Thomas Paine was one of the most instructive men I have ever known. He had a surprising memory and a brilliant fancy. His mind was a storehouse of facts and useful observations. He was full of lively anecdote and ingenious, original, pertinent remarks upon almost every subject. At the same time, another Paine contemporary would warn, "The name is enough. Every person has ideas of him. Some respect his genius and dread the man. Some reverence his political while they hate his religious opinions. Some love the man but not his private manners. Indeed, he has done nothing which has not extremes in it. He never appears, but we love and hate him. He is as great a paradox as ever appeared in human nature. Chapter 2. Begotten by a Wild Boar on a Bitch Wolf. It is an ironic symmetry of history how Thomas Paine was carried out of America, for his nearly lifeless body had similarly arrived in the New World between December the 7th and 12th, 1774, its condition a result of 18th-century maritime travel, when a 10-to-13-week, 3,500-mile Atlantic crossing was so perilous that prudent men ensured their wills were in order before embarking. Traveling to the other side of the world meant facing the threats of marine storms, becalmings, icebergs, pilot error, and rotted food, not to mention state-sanctioned buccaneering. Ships were blown off course to find themselves making land in the West Indies or North Africa. It was such an arduous journey that on his first crossing, John Adams would provision himself, his son John Quincy, and their servant with ink, paper, account books, 25 quill pens, a dozen clay pipes, tobacco, a pocket-sized pistol, 2 hogs, 2 fat sheep, 6 dozen chickens, 5 bushels of corn, 14 dozen eggs, a keg of rum, a barrel of Madeira, 4 dozen bottles of port, tea, chocolate, brown sugar, mustard, pepper, a box of wafers, a bag of Indian meal, and a barrel of apples. The year of Paine's crossing, one brigantine took 3 months to reach the New World. More than 100 of its passengers, 1/3 of the manifest, died of starvation, their bodies shedded to Atlantic tombs. Added to these perils was the era's woeful state of medical science, unchanged since Galen's second-century theory of humors, which attempted to cure all physical and mental illness through a balance of black bile, yellow bile, phlegm, and blood. The state-of-the-art medical school, the University of Edinburgh, had in its pharmacy every cure known to modern science, including ant eggs, frog sperm, pigeon blood, spider webs, human skulls, a choice of horse, pig, or peacock feces, and mummies. One of the era's richest men, Matthew Bolton, was prescribed peacock dung along with mistletoe, elk claw, camphor, and seahorse teeth to cure his adored wife Mary's hysterics, her epilepsy. Mary died. Life expectancy then was 36.6 years, with 1/5 of women dying in childbirth. One terrible but not a typical example of infant mortality was the family of the artist Goya. His wife, Josefa, became pregnant 20 times, gave birth to 7 children, and saw only one of them survive to adulthood. Under such conditions, spending 9 weeks in close contact with 120 German and English indentured servants sailing in steerage from England to Philadelphia was perilous in and of itself. One of only 5 cabin passengers on his voyage, Thomas Paine described his experience in a March 4, 1775 letter to his benefactor. "I did not sail in the vessel I first intended, it not having proper conveniences, but in the London packet, Captain Cook. The exchange was much for the worse. A putrid fever, probably louse-carried epidemic typhus, broke out among the servants, having and 120 on board, which, though not very fatal, was dismal and dangerous. We buried 5, and not above that number escaped the disease. By good providence, we had a doctor on board who entered himself as one of the servants, otherwise we must have been in as deplorable a situation as a passage of 9 weeks could have rendered us. 2 cabin passengers escaped the illness, owing, I believe, to their being almost constantly seasick the first 3 weeks. I had no serious illness, but suffered dreadfully with a fever. I had very little hopes that the captain or myself would live to see America. Dr. Caresley of this place attended the ship on her arrival, and when he understood that I was on your recommendation, he provided a lodging for me, and sent two of his men with a chaise to bring me on shore, for I could not at that time turn in my bed without help. With debilitating headache, fever, chills, nausea, fatigue, and a rash covering his entire body, the nearly comatose Paine was convinced he would die before seeing anything of the new world, and in fact was so delirious with fever that he was initially unaware that he had successfully traversed the Atlantic and arrived at the docks of Philadelphia. At this critical moment, he received medical attention, due to a packet of letters of recommendation written by that same benefactor, which very likely saved his life. Dr. John Caresley arranged not only to have two men hoist Paine ashore in a blanket, but would give him room and board for 6 weeks of recovery, during which time the feverish Paine would continue to need help just to turn over in bed. How an itinerant staymaker, taxman, grocer, teacher, widower, and divorcee, who'd relentlessly failed in everything personal and professional he had ever attempted, acquired these letters, and how he ended up delirious with fever on the shores of William Penn's Quaker Utopia is a story so preposterous it could only be true. The January 29th, 1737 birth of Thomas Paine, as he would spell it P-A-I-N until becoming famous, Paine, P-A-I-N-E, being more commonly used in the United Colonies, was a biological miracle, a Rousseau dream, and an English class system nightmare. His 40-year-old Anglican mother, Frances, was the daughter of a Thetford lawyer, so popular and successful that he would be named town clerk, cementing the family's status in the local elite. Paine's 29-year-old Quaker father, Joseph, on the other hand, was a master craftsman so poor he would have to borrow money from his spinster sister-in-law to afford the local grammar school's fees for Thomas's supplies. The adult Paine would display evidence of having been an only child, with his dazzling precocity, occasional self-absorption, characteristic self-esteem, a well-developed sense of entitlement, and an active internal life. The Paines lived in a small thatch-roofed home on Bridgegate Street in a neighborhood known as the Wilderness, close by the county of Norfolk's medieval jail hewn from black flint, and within view of the slight rise in elevation of Gallows Hill. The most popular entertainment of the age was the thrill of the hangman's noose, with executions the only public holidays for workers besides Christmas and Easter, thus allowing apprentices, servants, and the working poor to mull the consequence of villainy. As 18th-century England had 200 crimes punishable by death, with theft the most common capital offense, and executions meted out even when the accused was starving, and even for remarkable petty gains, a handkerchief, 20 shillings, a box of tea, the Court of Common Pleas hearings, known as the Lent Assizes, held every March at Thetford's Guildhall, would be crowded with thousands of locals and holiday-making tourists hoping for good courtroom drama, followed by the Christian justice of a public hanging. Every spring, scores of hooded peasant convicts arrived to face the branding iron, life imprisonment, transport to the outlying colonies, or a session on the ducking stool at the River Thet. Those refused such mercies of the court would be led to the chalk ridge overlooking the Paine cottage, their bodies left to swing for an hour as the townspeople watched and laid wager as to the time of their passing. The Paines lived among the 2,000 farmers, unskilled laborers, indentured servants, apprentices, journeymen, master craftsmen, merchants, and gentry of Thetford, a thousand-year-old East Anglia town built at the confluence of the rivers Thet and Little Ouse, 78 miles northeast of London, on the border of Norfolk and Suffolk, at the dead center of the Brecklands in Britain's swollen eastern belly. The Breck see little rainfall, but hosts great acreage of river, pond, lake, and marshland, teeming with beaver, otter, whinchat, stone curlew, nightjar, and hen harrier, against a landscape of heath, pines, lichens, heather, cattail, reed, sedge, valerian, and devil's bit scabious. In the 12th century, local farmers so overgrazed their sheep and rabbits that the area suffered immense sandstorms for the next 500 years, and those inland dunes can still be seen. Today, the region is home to paper mills and turkey farms and a thriving community of expatriate Portuguese. But in Paine's day, it was a center of malt grain and metalwork, blacksmiths, whitesmiths, and foundries, thanks to its terribly infertile but rich in clay soils. Brecklands means literally pasture that must lay fallow or in brake for 9 years every 10. Only the 20th century's application of irrigation, fertilizer, insecticide, and herbicide would make the area suitable for wide-scale agriculture. In the 18th century, farmers relied on oats, groats, and goats. The Danes had established Thetford as East Anglia's capital, and the Normans had made it their holy see. But in 1095, the county government moved to Norwich, and the town, with barges to the Great Ouse and service on the post road to London, became a place sailed by and ridden through on the river or road to somewhere else. As was true in England as a whole, 5% of Paine's neighbors were aristocrats and gentry, doctors, lawyers, and land-owning yeomen and clergy, while 95% were rural paupers trying to survive the enclosure movement when common folk were suddenly forbidden to graze their herds, hunt, or forage on 3.4 million acres of now private grounds. Eventually, this measure would transform English agriculture and provide a year-round supply of fresh meat. But in the short term, it meant destitution for those who had depended on those no longer communal lands. The century's closing years would force Norfolk's agrarian poor, like many rural Europeans, into rioting and looting for food. Paine's childhood home was a pocket or rotten borough, its electorate controlled by the local aristocrats, the Graftons, who resided at the 40-mile-in-circumference property Euston Hall, and who paid the salaries and expenses of Thetford's mayor, alderman, mace-bearer, sword-bearer, and its two members of parliament. Of the town's 2,000 citizens, 31 could vote, which was representative of the country as a whole, with its population of 5 million and its suffrage of 6,000 erratically applied. When one particularly aesthetic Grafton decided that the village of Euston was interfering with the beauty of the view from his bedroom window, he simply had the entire town and its inhabitants removed. Thomas Paine was baptized and confirmed in the Church of England and would call himself Anglican until his first years in America. As a child, however, he regularly accompanied his father Joseph to services at the Quaker meeting house. Many of the adult Paine's progressive notions would be ascribed to these early experiences, even though he would often find himself at odds with the Friends, fiercely attacking the Loyalist Quakers in Pennsylvania during the American Revolution, and noting that if the taste of a Quaker could have been consulted at the creation, what a silent and drab-colored creation it would have been. Not a flower would have blossomed its gaieties, nor a bird been permitted to sing. When his pet bird died, the 8-year-old author, at an age when many of his schoolmates were statistically perishing, composed his first writing to survive history, an epitaph with a suitably Quaker admonition. "Here lies the body of John Crow, who once was high but now is low. Ye brother crows, take warning all, for as you rise, so must you fall." The Paines attended a meeting house on Cage Lane, so named since adjacent to the dissenters' building was the cage, pillory, and stocks for the condemned overflow of Thetford Prison. During Quaker services, young Thomas would have been surrounded by the sad colors, autumnal greens, dun wheats, and wintry barks of the congregants' clothing, while listening to prayer and testimony intermingled with bellowing wails, screams for mercy, and the taunts of locals having a grand old time tormenting the criminals on public display next door. Having been raised in two religions simultaneously during a period when competing doctrines waged armed warfare against one another could have triggered Paine's adult tendency to question all received wisdom. However, such an upbringing was not all that uncommon, and one of his few surviving memories about this issue seems to prove that in the battle over young Thomas's beliefs, neither friend nor Anglican would prevail. I well remember, when about 7 or 8 years of age, hearing a sermon read by a relation of mine, who was a great devotee of the church, upon the subject of what is called redemption by the death of the Son of God. After the sermon was ended, I went into the garden, and as I was going down the garden steps, for I perfectly recollect the spot, I revolted at the recollection of what I had heard, and thought to myself that it was making God Almighty act like a passionate man that killed his son when he could not revenge himself any other way. And, as I was sure a man would be hanged that did such a thing, I could not see for what purpose they preached such sermons. This was not one of those kind of thoughts that had anything in it of childish levity. It was to me a serious reflection, arising from the idea I had that God was too good to do such an action, and also too almighty to be under any necessity of doing it. I believe in the same manner to this moment, and I moreover believe that any system of religion that has anything in it that shocks the mind of a child cannot be a true system. At the age of 6, Thomas began attending the local grammar school, where his parents' class differences would become manifest. Father Joseph was a master craftsman staymaker, engineering the rigid foundation garment that created the heaving-bosomed, wasp-waisted shape of every desirable 18th-century English woman. Stays were made from leather or linen, with ribs of paste, steel, or whalebone. They came as pairs, laced together up the sides with ribbon, according to how much air a woman wished to breathe, and resembled body armor. Like a bodice, they were designed to be seen, with the poorest women wearing nothing else but a skirt, while the majority would at least have a mantua, a dress with upper folds exposing a coordinated pair of stays. As was the case with all artisans, Paine's primary creditors and most significant customers were local merchants, aristocrats, and gentry. When the economy soured and the bills of the well-to-do went unpaid, artisans were the first to be thrown into debtors' prison. By 1759, the 20,000 incarcerated had so overwhelmed London's Fleet Penitentiary for debtors that there was no room for the newest convicts, who were ordered instead to live nearby. They were comparatively lucky. Fleet's annual mortality rate was 1/4 its population. The son of an artisan would typically expect to receive only a basic education in reading, writing, math, measuring, and bookkeeping, with perhaps some specialized teaching, depending on the field for which he would apprentice. As the grandson of a lawyer, however, Thomas would additionally be expected to become fluent in Latin. Grammar in the 18th century meant Latin grammar, along with rhetoric, geometry, logic, dancing, and at least a smattering of Greek, all in preparation for college, and then a career in the law, the church, or the healing arts. There were exceptions to this standard, memorably for that son of a glover, William Shakespeare. Paine would spend 6 years at Thetford Grammar, so it seems his parents were hoping that their only child would escape the frightful economics of craftsmanship. Like so many of that era's independent artisans, the Paine family business drifted at a permanent edge of falter. And the adult Paine would remember that as a child, the natural bent of my mind was to science, which would seem to give Latin every educational priority. But my father, being of the Quaker profession, it was my good fortune to have an exceedingly good moral education and a tolerable stock of useful learning. Though I went to the grammar school, I did not learn Latin, not only because I had no inclination to learn languages, but because of the objection the Quakers have against the books in which the language is taught. But this did not prevent me from being acquainted with the subjects of all the Latin books used in the school. At the age of 12, with the family able to afford no other options, it cost 100 guineas to apprentice with a London grocer, £300 to join a brewery or pharmacy, and £600 for banking or surgery, Thomas ended his formal education and his one chance to escape the destiny of his father's class and began an apprenticeship in staymaking. Just as his 7 years of learning to custom-fit foundation garments came to an end, however, the world went to war. Like all global conflicts, this one began as an insignificant quibble. When in 1753, a 21-year-old future friend of Paine's, who had recently inherited the rank of major in the Virginia militia when his half-brother died of tuberculosis, was sent on a mission. British Virginia had heard rumors that the French were constructing forts along the western territories of the Ohio River, and the colony's governor sent this boy, volunteering for his first military assignment, to deliver a letter demanding that they immediately withdraw. The young major returned to the capital with the news that the French had refused to comply, and after a promotion to lieutenant colonel, he and a battalion were ordered to march to the Monongahela to reinforce British troops guarding the frontier. As the redcoats tramped slowly through the wilderness, the area's locals, 20,000 Iroquois, kept them informed of what lay ahead, especially the fearful rumor that the French had already defeated the British at the fort that was their destination. Just before they reached the river, Iroquois chieftain Half-King sent word that a party of French soldiers was waiting just ahead of them, and that his warriors would be glad to help the British kill them all. On May the 28th, 1754, at 7 a.m., 40 Virginians and 12 Iroquois assaulted 30 Frenchmen, killing 10 in a battle lasting for 15 minutes. The lieutenant colonel wrote his little brother that "I heard the bullets whistle, and believe me, there is something charming in the sound." In fact, these Frenchmen were not aggressive soldiers but diplomatic agents, and the young man who, with that attack, started what would become the First Global War was George Washington. 2 years later, Prussia's Frederick II the Great invaded Saxony, and these minor skirmishes triggered an epic clash of France, Austria, Saxony, Sweden, and Russia against Prussia, Hanover, and Great Britain, with battlefields in Europe, Africa, India, on the oceans, and in the New World. In the end, the key to victory in the 7 Years' War would turn out to be an enormous strategic debt incurred by the rheumy-eyed First Minister of England, William Pitt, the great commoner Whig for whom Pittsburgh is named. With colonials paid to fight in America and Prussians hired for Germany, Pitt both protected his king's ancestral homeland of Hanover on one continent and made Britain the world's foremost colonial power on the other. Like all wars, this one provided a cornucopia of opportunity for fearless young men, offering any number of positions that didn't require fluency in Latin or fluidity in sewing. Just after those first Saxony battles in the summer of 56, perhaps additionally inspired by the recently published adventures of Robinson Crusoe and Gulliver, Thomas Paine left home. Raw and adventurous, and heated with the false heroism of a master who had served in a man of war, his grammar school teacher, I began the carver of my own fortune. Soon after he arrived in London, a notice in the Daily Advertiser caught his eye. "To cruise against the French, the terrible privateer Captain William Death, all gentlemen sailors and able-bodied landmen who are inclinable to try their fortune as well as serve their king and country are desired to repair on board the said ship." Paine was making his way to the docks to sign up for the romantic life of a buccaneer when he heard someone calling his name. It was his father, Joseph, who had tracked him down through tips from his fellow master craftsmen. Joseph was able to convince his son to reconsider a career on the high seas, which likely saved his life. For immediately after entering the channel, the Terrible fell under assault from a French privateer, the Vengeance. Only 17 English crewmen survived, while more than 150 died, including Captain Death himself. Joseph, however, either could not or did not persuade Thomas to return with him to Thetford. Instead, in the wake of a strike, London tailors and staymen having formed England's first union in 1720, the younger Paine was able to acquire a position under master craftsman John Morris amid the bars and brothels of Hanover Street in Covent Garden, directly adjacent to the Hogarth immortalized slum of St. Giles's. Then, on January the 17th, 1757, he returned to the docks, ready again for the great gamble of his age, signing on to crew for Captain Mendez and the King of Prussia. Instead of suffering the dreadful fate of the terrible, Prussia went on to capture the treasure of 8 enemy vessels in as many months, with Paine returning to London on August the 20th in triumph. His extant documents mention almost nothing about this wartime service, and it is unknown how he retired after a mere 6 months, but Prussia's record of conquest would mean at least £30 in commission, around $5,000 today. A grand fortune for a young man just beginning to make his way in the world. Thomas Paine would so fall in love with the city of London at this moment that he would return to it again and again, even at the peril of his freedom. A tall, for his era, 5'9", he had a striking face with wavy brown hair and such dazzling blue eyes he was convinced that with one look any woman would fall hopelessly in love with him. Paine's nose, however, was strikingly bulbous, and eventually it would be suffused with a skin condition, perhaps rosacea. The young man about London could now afford to exchange his Thetford country bumpkin homespun for proper clothing, linen shirt with a front ruffle of lace, damask coat lined with silk, waistcoat embroidered with gold or silver thread, knee breeches, garters, silk stockings, leather shoes with silver buckles, and a felt hat. As far as we know, Paine never used ceruse, a white lead powder used to camouflage the scars of smallpox, mouse skins to accentuate his eyebrows, or randomly applied beauty marks, popular with both sexes at the time, and he certainly never aspired to the fashions of the rich, such as Massachusetts import-export titan John Hancock, with his lavender suits, mink coats, and blinding yellow phaeton. With a little more luck, however, it's certain that Paine, the vain optimist, would have commissioned a full-length portrait in those salad years, posing with one leg fully twisted, the heel facing the viewer, and showing, to the fullest extent possible, that era's symbol of male power, the calf. Our common impression of the 18th century is drawn from the perspective of a man such as Hancock, a life of eternal Mozart and minuet, plectrum and brocade, of winking fans and dying candlelight. In fact, the age of revolution offered more than a few compelling reasons to revolt. For every maquillage-bearing Versailles minion, there was an abrasive, monochromatic Puritan heretic. And nowhere can this duality be seen more emphatically than in the homes of the very rich. Though the century's most popular colors were relentlessly pallid, dim blues, faint roses, pale grays, those autumnal sad colors with beige, ivory, and bleach white leading all, the latter seen in both male and female faces, pancaked into rigor mortis eclipse as well as on talc-dusted snowy wigs made from horsehair, goat hair, human hair, and duck feathers, the upper crust did not follow this tonal scheme with their decorating. Georgian architects mandated a strict nub of geometric precision for the exteriors of buildings, including double-squared facade widths that always equaled the heights of the chimneys. The interiors, however, were not executed with the same austere minimalism. Walls were painted in lurid fruity glosses, acid lemons, screaming apricots, aquatic limes, or outfitted in embossed leathers and scenic mock-flock wallpapers. Unlike most successful privateers, Thomas Paine didn't spend all his winnings on clothes, gin, and women. Instead, as soon as I was able, I purchased a pair of globes and attended the philosophical lectures of Martin and Ferguson, and became afterwards acquainted with Dr. Beavis of the society called the Royal Society, then living in the Temple, and an excellent astronomer. Historians have long wondered exactly how this lower class rarely do well became the most popular author of the 18th century and famed citizen of the world. He did it, we know now, in a signature American fashion, a rigorous course of self-improvement leading to personal reinvention, inspired by one of the most remarkable transformations of thought in world history. Thomas Paine would spend only a few years in London, but they would make of him a central figure in the creation of the modern world. When this 20-year-old returned to that city of 650,000 souls in 1757, he was immediately confronted by all that made his time such a staggering dichotomy. For London then contained the dazzling heights of Western civilization, directly alongside a vertiginous maw of human depravity. Great sophistication, elegance, and beauty were found in the squares of Berkeley, Bloomsbury, Cavendish, and Grosvenor, the sights of an existence so elevated that Talleyrand would explain it by saying that if one had not lived as an aristocrat before the French Revolution, one could never know the full sweetness of life. At the same time, squalor, stench, and filth infected the slums of Whitechapel, St. Giles's, Cheapside, and Houndsditch, so named for being the preferred final resting place of city pets, along with grotesque amounts of pollution. "If I would drink water," Tobias Smollett reported, "I must quaff the mawkish contents of an open aqueduct, exposed to all manner of defilement, or swallow that which comes from the River Thames, impregnated with all the filth of London and Westminster. Human excrement is the least offensive part of the concrete, which is composed of all the drugs, minerals, and poisons used in mechanics and manufacture, enriched with the putrefying carcasses of beasts and men, and mixed with the scourings of all the washtubs, kennels, and common sewers." For entertainment, blue bloods might spend the evening strolling across the concert halls, pavilions, tents, ruins, promenades, and supper booths of the pleasure gardens of Ranelagh or Vauxhall, or perhaps enjoy the antics of the mentally ill offered up at the Hospital of St. Mary of Bethlehem, Bedlam, followed by dinner and a whore at the popular London Bagnos, highly recommended as a great bargain by none other than Casanova. A rich man can sup, bathe, and sleep with a fashionable courtesan. It makes a magnificent debauch, and only costs 6 guineas. There were more wholesome entertainments, of course. John Adams's daughter Nabby would remember a London vaudeville show starring a learned pig, dancing dogs, and a little hare that beats a drum. The hoi polloi, meanwhile, could enjoy bare-knuckled boxing, cockfights, dogfights, and one very popular game of chance, cockshaling, which involved throwing a club at a chicken tied to a distant post, with the successful executioner winning the well-tenderized bird. A visit to the Tower Zoo cost a mere 6 pence, while a few pence less paid for a spot at the bear, bull, and badger-baiting haunts outside Bloomsbury. If you were too poor to afford even that, there were many pleasures that cost nothing at all, such as throwing garbage at the prisoners held in the stocks of Charing Cross, enjoying the screams at the whipping station at Bridewell, and watching the final dance of the hangman's noose at Newgate. The most popular sport of the 18th century London poor, however, remained constant, full-fledged rioting. These episodes of democratic rout had become so frequent that British army troops were stationed nearby to assist the remarkably ineffectual municipal constables in quelling the violence against property. While working in London, Ben Franklin once wrote, "Do you Englishmen then pretend to censure the colonies for riots? Look at home. I have seen within a year riots in the county about corn, riots about elections, riots about workhouses, riots of colliers, riots of weavers, riots of coal heavers, riots of sawyers, riots of sailors, riots of Wilkites, riots of government chairmen, riots of smugglers. In America, if one mob breaks a few windows or tars and feathers a single rascally informer, it is called rebellion. Troops and fleets must be sent, and military execution talked of as the decentest thing in the world. Here, indeed, one would think riots part of the mode of government. At the same time, no matter how stringently the Hanoverians kept adding to their list of crimes deemed worthy of execution, it seemed to have little effect on urban miscreants. Novelist and magistrate Henry Fielding said of London that the whole appears as a vast wood or forest in which a thief may harbor with as great security as wild beasts do in the deserts of Africa or Arabia. One of the era's underworld potentates, Jonathan Wilde, was believed to have 7,000 employees. There was one prostitute for every 12 men, with girls beginning that line of work when they reached the age of consent, 12. If, of course, they managed to reach that age. Almost 60% of Londoners would die before the age of 10, with more than 9,000 children perishing from drinking gin in 1751 alone, a year when one quarter of all the homes in St. Giles's sold homemade eau de genièvre. The city's 1758 Bill of Mortality is a striking account of this suffering. Christened, 14,209. Buried, 17,576. Whereof have died under 2 years of age, 5,971. Between 2 and 5, 1,795. 5 and 10, 717. 10 and 20, 556. 20 and 30, 1,362. 30 and 40, 1,589. Of convulsion, 4,417. Consumption, 3,411. Fever, malignant fever, scarlet fever, and purples, 2,472. Smallpox, 1,273. With such extremes in their capital, is it any wonder that the London rich would spend the last years of the 18th century reading French news of guillotines and heads on pikes and wondering in growing panic when they would be similarly set upon by their own starving masses? At the very moment that Thomas Paine arrived in London, however, he would find that alongside the squalor and inequity, the discoveries of the Renaissance were culminating in a 200-year apex, escaping the confines of the academy, the clergy, and the nobility to become a part of the very fabric of everyday urban life. Technology, society, science, and politics were each undergoing a staggering upheaval that would reorder the course of history, producing in the midst of this barbaric feudal society what could only be considered a wholly new culture, including a wholly new way of thinking and a wholly new religion, a religion of light. Just as Petrarch had announced in the 14th century that the era of ignorance and darkness was over and that an era of renewal of Renaissance was about to begin, so did one 18th-century philosopher after the next in Paine's time proclaim the imminent birth of an entirely new world. In time, a global avant-garde of highly educated, hard-working progressives, dedicated to making the most of their lives through a program of self-improvement, education, communication, invention, pragmatism, natural philosophy, and virtue, gathered in communities of correspondence as each in turn underwent a great awakening, an enlightenment. As their intellectual and spiritual Renaissance ancestors had done, these 18th-century moderns traveled across continents and oceans to meet and debate, turned conversation into an art form, and strove to tolerate, if not even assimilate, contrary opinion in a universal search for truth among cosmopolitan gentlemen. The humanists had rescued the great works of classical Rome and Greece from monk-controlled Athenaeums. The enlightened would learn Cicero, Seneca, Catullus, and Tacitus from these scrolls and use their words for direction and inspiration. The intellectual and spiritual connection between the elite of the Medici and Georgian centuries was so powerful, in fact, that one historian would call the American Revolution the last great act of the Renaissance. If the educated of this era rejected aristocracy by birth to create their own cliques of merit, meeting through clubs, societies, friends, and acquaintances, then the biggest clique of all was a global effort of moderns carried on through correspondence, John Locke's Republic of Letters, reading one another's books, pamphlets, and articles, as well as an endless exchange of quill-scratched missives. In a sense, writing a letter was an 18th-century form of media. You expected that besides the recipient, everyone in his or her family would read your letter. Everyone nearby who knew you would also want a look. Very likely, the friend carrying the letter for you and anyone he might run into along the way would read it. And if you were a public figure, the recipient's local newspaper would publish it. The volume of correspondence was stupefying. Princeton University currently expects to finish publishing Thomas Jefferson's 75 volumes of papers, consisting of the estimated 20,000 letters he sent and the 30,000 he received in 2026. Harvard's Adams Family Papers, meanwhile, are expected to total 150 volumes. It is clear, in fact, that the epistolary stalwarts of this era wrote letters convinced that we today would be reading them as well. They sensed that they were on the stage of history, that the future would be watching. Everyone knew one another in this remarkably small world. In May of 1771, to take one example, Benjamin Franklin decided to meet in person his correspondents in the British Midlands. He visited a marble works, Joseph Priestley, caverns, a silk mill, Erasmus Darwin, an ironworks, James Watt, the Bridgewater Canal, and Matthew Bolton in his Soho manufactory. In other words, nearly every key figure of England's Industrial Revolution. One London publisher, Joseph Johnson, meanwhile, would include among his authors Thomas Paine, Erasmus Darwin, John Aiken, Thomas Erskine, Henry Fuseli, William Godwin, Richard Price, Joseph Priestley, Mary Wollstonecraft, William Hazlitt, Thomas Robert Malthus, and William Wordsworth. One author, Immanuel Kant, offered a primer to those hoping to join this new global movement. Enlightenment is man's leaving his self-caused immaturity. Immaturity is the incapacity to use one's intelligence without the guidance of another. Saupere aude, dare to know, citing Roman poet Horace. Have the courage to use your own intelligence is therefore the motto of the Enlightenment. All that is required for this Enlightenment is freedom, and particularly the least harmful of all that may be called freedom, namely the freedom for man to make public use of his reason in all matters. The question may now be put, do we live at present in an enlightened age? The answer is no, but in an age of enlightenment. Much still prevents men from being placed in a position or even being placed into position to use their own minds securely. Eventually, the government is also influenced by this free thought, and thereby it treats man, who is now more than a machine, according to his dignity. Kant was able to have a worldwide bestseller with this essay through a singular Renaissance invention, the printing press. The 18th century would transform printing, publishing, and writing into commerce with the invention of hot metal type and the extraordinary new popularity of reading itself. This last development, without which the Enlightenment would never have existed, was in large part generated by a remarkably unlikely source, none other than the great scourge of the papists. A cornerstone of Martin Luther's doctrine was that everyone, even the lowliest of women and children should be able to commune directly with God by reading the Bible. In his wake, churches of the 16th and 17th centuries began widespread instruction in literacy. By the 18th, many European state governments would take over this responsibility, with the result that a huge swath of the public would become literate. Autobiographical essays would be published on the great revolution in thinking, imagination, and social status brought forth by learning to read. Illiterates were, for the first time, considered mentally suspect. When the 14-year-old William Cobbett first saw Jonathan Swift's A Tale of a Tub in a store window, he spent every pence he had to get it. The book was so different, it delighted me beyond description, and it produced what I have always considered a sort of birth of intellect. East London cooper Will Crooks found a used Iliad selling for tuppence and decided to take a browse. What a revelation it was to me! Pictures of romance and beauty I had never dreamed of suddenly opened up before my eyes. I was transported from the East End to an enchanted land. It was a rare luxury for a working lad like me, just home from work, to find myself suddenly among the heroes and nymphs of ancient Greece. Some historians have even come to think that this mass eruption of literacy marked the very origins of adulthood itself, noting that in such pre-18th century painters as Bruegel, a whole town's population is in the street at dusk playing the games of children. After Luther, there would be two kinds of Europeans, those initiated into the illuminating world of print and those still playing with hoops. As the century progressed, the number of books published in England would mushroom from 6,000 in 1620 to 21,000 in the 1710s and 56,000 in the 1790s, while newspaper sales would rise from 2.5 million in the 1710s to 12 million in the 1770s and 16 million by 1801. Advances in printing technology transformed publishing to a new scale of economy and gave rise to the era's favored method of public discourse, the pamphlet, the medium employed in years to come by the Enlightenment's premier evangelist, Thomas Paine. This same economy would also make possible a new overnight sensation, the library. Previously, a middle or working class family might own a Bible, some other inspirational spiritual volumes, and a few business necessaries such as almanacs, and read them over and over. Now they subscribed to circulation libraries or created their own collections by patronizing booksellers whose shops became a nexus where the educated met and socialized. Before 1710, a monopoly on copyrights had been owned by London stationers, and writers were either independently wealthy or beholden to patrons. England then amended its law so that publishers now had to pay authors for rights. Before 1710, there were no printer publishers outside London. By the 1790s, there would be 1,000, based in more than 300 towns and cities. While the number of men employed in the London printing business exploded from 198 in 1668 to 3,365 in 1818. Oliver Goldsmith observed that his fellow authors no longer depend on the great for subsistence. They have now no other patrons but the public, and the public, collectively considered, is a good and generous master. Goldsmith wrote bestsellers. Europeans were now reading both because they had to and for pleasure. The term autobiography first appeared, and novels such as Tristram Shandy and the world's first celebrity author Lawrence Stern revealed the beginnings of modern psychology in portraiture. Henry Fielding would declare in the history of Tom Jones, a Foundling, 1749, that I am, in reality, the founder of a new province of writing, so I am at liberty to make whatever laws I please therein. The first science fiction, the first children's books, and the first magazine exclusively for women were introduced, as was Johnson's Dictionary of the English Language in 1755 and the Encyclopaedia Britannica in 1768, these latter serving as testament to the boom, not just in reading, but in self-education, an Enlightenment hallmark. In the entry Encyclopédie of the Encyclopédie, Denis Diderot explained that his purpose was to collect all knowledge scattered over the face of the earth and to transmit this to those who will come after us, so that our children, by becoming more educated, may at the same time become more virtuous and happier, and that we may not die without having deserved well of the human race. In such a spirit did gentlemen across Europe produce volume after volume, attempting to establish an ordering of everything, from Johnson's Dictionary to Erasmus Darwin's Zoonomia, to Joseph Priestley's History of Electricity and Uppsala botanist Carolus Linnaeus's Systema Naturae, in which he invented the genus-species classification and naming system used in biology today. Linnaeus would additionally hold a place in history for convincing Europeans that there were no such things as dragons. This rise in literacy and publishing cascaded into an explosive era of innovation. From 1660 to 1760, England granted around 60 patents per decade. From 1760 to 1790, the average jumped to 325. The first restaurants appeared. The systems of Fahrenheit and Celsius were invented. Hospitals that actually tried to cure the sick instead of merely offering beds for them to die in were constructed. Stores stopped being addendums to workshops and became the forerunners of today's retail, in which shopping would be considered a pleasurable activity. Opening in 1759 to display the oddments collected by Sir Hans Sloane, the British Museum offered displays not only for the inspection and entertainment of the learned and the curious, but for the general use and benefit of the public. This made it the first public museum, even though it was a difficult venue for working men to enjoy, being closed on weekends and holidays and tickets taking months to obtain. In its first year, only 60 visitors were allowed to peer inside. Reading for education and pleasure was creating one kind of cultural revolution. Addictive drugs would initiate the other. The 17th century had been for England 100 years of violent tumult, with 2 civil wars, a glorious revolution, ongoing battles with the rest of Europe, endless civil disorder over religion. Practically no English stained glass survives today, as it was shattered in the anti-Catholic rages of the Reformation and the civil wars. A countrywide siege of alcoholism from the introduction of gin, a 1665 epidemic of bubonic plague that killed 100,000 Londoners in that year alone, and a cataclysmic fire in 1666 that destroyed 13,000 London buildings, nearly the entire city. All this had taken a great toll on the political power of both the king and the noble families, as well as on the public reputation of anyone inclining toward political or spiritual extremism. The rising European middle class, mechanics and merchants both, had had enough, as captured in the lifelong motto of Talleyrand, "Surtout pas de zèle," above all, no zealotry. For the first time, a new gentry could afford to indulge in the latest imported addictions. Linnaeus proposed naming hot cocoa the drink of the gods, as well as the time to enjoy such pleasures as cooking with sugar, snuffing tobacco, quaffing rum, infusing tea, eating chocolates, and most especially, drinking coffee. Originating in Constantinople, and first popular in England with Protestants abstaining from anything and everything under Cromwell, the institution of the coffee house expanded dramatically. In 1663, there were 82 London coffee houses. By 1734, there were 551. As the century turned, it brought with it an almost natural evolution from coffee drinking to conversation to business opportunities to business meetings, an evolution that would essentially draw the very society of London itself out of the courts of the boorish Hanoverians and into the coffee houses, chocolate houses, and taverns of the middle class, which became nicknamed tattling universities. Soon enough, men like-minded in business or hobby began making regular appearances at set locations and turned them into clubs. There were clubs specializing in poetry, foreign affairs, politics, singing, and farting. import-export traders working the Baltic gathered at the Threadneedle Street Coffee House while James Boswell and Ben Franklin joined fellow honest Whigs to pay 18 pence every other Thursday at St. Paul's for beer, punch or wine, Welsh rarebit, and apple puffs. One coffee house, New Jonathan's, attracted a club of bankers who eventually became the London Stock Exchange. Artisans gathered at the Robin Hood Tavern to pay sixpence for beer and a chance to say anything a mind could produce, as long as it didn't exceed 5 minutes. Even as small a burg as Glasgow was blessed with the pig, the grog, the accidental, the hodgepodge, and the what-you-please clubs. Some gatherings were dazzling in their membership. Politician Edmund Burke, playwright Oliver Goldsmith, painter Joshua Reynolds, historian Edward Gibbon, and economist Adam Smith could be found at Dr. Johnson's literary club meeting at the Turk's Head on Gerrard Street in Soho. The favorite club of the Duke of Grafton, Paine's childhood aristocrat, was the Kit Kat, named for a popular style of mutton pie, and frequented by power Whigs. Lord Chancellor Somers, the Duke of Marlborough, and the first Earl of Orford, Sir Robert Walpole, as well as such writers as Steele, Addison, and Congreve. Beyond its impatience with zealots and its caffeinated temperance, this new and enlightened society championed tolerance, diversity, psychology, economics, reason, logic, courtesy, manners, and an elevated sense of urban bonhomie. Its members, however, needed a guide to make their way through this revolutionary new world, and they found it in an anthology of decades-old newspapers. Conceived by Kit Kat Club associates Richard Steele, hoping to escape bankruptcy, and Joseph Addison, seeking a way out of academe, and published 6 days a week from 1711 to 1714, The Spectator would have a profound effect on the century's new meritocrats, as it would be read during its greatest years by a quarter of the population of London, and its complete bound edition would ever afterwards be thought an essential element of every educated Englishman's library. Considered the first periodical to enjoy true mass readership, The Spectator was nothing like a magazine or newspaper of today. Instead of the latest news on the most glamorous celebrities, it focused on the celebration of ideas, presented in a series of essays written almost entirely by Addison and Steele, portraying the life of modern London as it hurtled inexorably away from the Ancien Régime and toward a regime of consumers who worked for a living, all inspired by Horace's encomium, motto ex fumo dare lucem, to turn the darkness light. Members of the Spectator Club, prudent, dignified merchant Sir Andrew Freeport, courageous retired soldier Captain Sentry, kind, foppish man about town Will Honeycomb, and eccentric, athletic country squire Sir Roger de Coverley, discoursed on the way to improve the happiness of all through a system of urbane courtesies and ethics greatly inspired by the philosophies of Aristotle and Locke. Writing from every coffee shop in the land, perhaps in a bid to match Voltaire's habit of 50 cups a day, was the paper's and this new society's eminence grise, Mr. Spectator, the prudent yet worldly wise urbanite who was fascinated by and tolerant of every human foible, whose education spanned the great books both ancient and modern, who could always make an analogy of current events from his wide-ranging travels in foreign lands, and whose commentary on London society regularly employed nature's gift of human reason to propose the correct behavior and elevated standards suitable for the cosmopolitan citizens of the world, that is, the readers of The Spectator. Rebuking Hobbes's vision of humanity like a vulpine mob snarling over the smallest inch of gristle, Addison and Steele envisioned the society of tomorrow as polite, relaxed, peaceful, and good-natured as the regular denizens of London's café society, moderate businessmen who enjoyed their work, their reading, and one another. Even Boswell aspired to follow in Mr. Spectator's footsteps, since a person of imagination and feeling such as the Spectator finely describes can have the most lively enjoyment. If happiness had a definition with this coterie, it would be the eudaimonism of Aristotle as recapitulated by Locke. I will faithfully pursue that happiness I propose to myself. All innocent diversions and delights, as far as they will contribute to my health, and consist with my improvement, condition, and my other more solid pleasures of knowledge and reputation, I will enjoy. This pursuit of happiness is one of many Aristotle-Locke spectator notions that would appear in various significant documents 60 years later on the other side of the world. Addison's Mr. Spectator was an apostle, bringing the ideas of the Enlightenment from the aristocrats and the academics to the middle and working classes, a position that would one day be assumed by Thomas Paine, who, at the height of his fame, would lead the life of a real-world Mr. Spectator, while a great many of Paine's radical ideas can be found 50 years before in the Good and Gentle newspaper's columns. Addison would also become something of an unacknowledged founding godfather of the United States, both through the Lockean notions cultivated in his essays for the paper and through his post-spectator work as a playwright. His drama Cato, the story of a virtuous senator fighting corruption, treason, and Julius Caesar in a last desperate plea for the final days of the Roman Republic, would become George Washington's moral and dramatic lodestone, first read with the great love of his life, the married Sally Fairfax, and so admired that he would have it performed during the brutal winter of Valley Forge to inspire his troops. When the Americans ultimately triumphed, but his officers threatened a coup d'etat against Congress over the nation's inability to pay their salaries, Washington used Cato's Act 3, Scene 5 tactics in facing down his own mutineers. Both left their audiences crying with guilt. John Adams had a favorite Cato motto: "We cannot ensure success, but we can deserve it." And Addison's writing is remembered today mostly through the Cato allusions of Patrick Henry, the original announcing, "It is not now a time to talk of aught but chains or conquest, liberty or death," and Nathan Hale's paraphrase, "How beautiful is death when earned by virtue, what pity is it that we can die but once to serve our country." Throughout the course of his writings, Paine would again and again take to heart Addison and Steele's utopian visions of liberty, equality, and sociability as the underpinnings of enlightened liberal democratic government. Even his epical argument with Edmund Burke over the French Revolution and the course of human history could be argued to have originated with the Arcadia espoused by the Spectator. Siding with Paine in that dispute means believing or hoping that an entire nation might be politically capable of being as civilized, educated, and rational as the customers of an 18th-century coffee house. Paine would cite Addison at various times, though there is no conclusive proof that he read The Spectator. In fact, there are few surviving instances of Paine saying that he read anything at all, which has led some historians to believe that he was a political science idiot savant. In fact, Paine's typical refusal to cite his sources likely resulted from a trend in rhetoric at that time where it was believed more convincing to rely on one's own reason than to cite a prior authority. It's implausible that he took part in the Enlightenment in London and the Revolution in Philadelphia and impressed such a panoply of his era's great thinkers without having read the same books that everyone else he knew had read. His closest, most famous friends during those years, Benjamin Franklin, Thomas Jefferson, and George Washington, were all Addison and Spectator acolytes who didn't just read the bound periodicals again and again, but would quote them and allude to them in letters, speeches, and conversations throughout their lives. Ultimately, it's not that the Spectator held the same concepts as Paine, as that its pages offered up an ambiance of utopian virtue for the new world in which his ideas would be born. A modern life blessed by public service, compassion, insight, sympathy, reason, benevolence, and merit. A life whose spirit, Paine, would strive to fulfill. The young Thomas Paine's life in London Café Society revolved around his profound interest in natural philosophy, the key Enlightenment enthusiasm that would sweep through every social class. The most ardent students of nature were, in fact, artisans, those self-employed master craftsmen and wage-earning journeymen like Paine, who made, in that pre-industrial era, pretty much everything money could buy, a group we remember today from such names as Waterman, Webster, Thatcher, Sawyer, Sherman, Mason, Miller, Draper, Chandler, Cooper, and Cutler. In the 18th century, they called themselves mechanics, and their great hero was the world's most celebrated self-made mechanic, Benjamin Franklin, who, in Poor Richard's Almanac, delineated their shared ideology. Hard work, fortitude.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.